Go developers often build applications and microservices that communicate with each other using messages and queues. Well, David Justice is here to show us some of the messaging service options available inside Azure for Go developers today on Azure Friday. Welcome to Azure Friday, everybody. I'm Eric St. Martin, and with me today is David Justice, who's going to talk about some of the messaging options that we have available as Go developers inside Azure.
Awesome. I'm very grateful to be here. Thank you, Eric. We have some really cool stuff that came up most recently with Go and messaging. So I'm going to lead us with a little bit of background on messaging in general and just kind of look at like the landscape for a second. So, generally with microservices, we try to communicate through dumb pipes, right? We don't want any real intelligence in it. And there's really two kind of schools of thought. The first one being like HTTP direct communication. So I have some service discovery in place. I have some services behind a load balancer. I'm going to go figure out like what a DNS entry is for it and just give them a call, right? That's cool. We can do that. We can also communicate through like queues, and we have really cool, strong enterprise messaging options in Azure. And I think we're going to dig into that today and compare and contrast those. So the old adage, do not communicate by sharing memory. Share memory by, what is it? Communicating, excuse me. So in HTTP messaging, we get like direct and it's simple. We don't really get any guarantees about whether the message gets there. We could try to infer that based on error codes. We are temporarily coupled, meaning that this service needs to be up for me to reach it with an HTTP call, right? You ever try to hit a service that isn't there?
Rolling restarts, things like this. You just happen to hit it in that, that sweet spot where it's down.
Yep. Oops. So then we build in like libraries to do retries, and we have sidecars to do it. We have all sorts of stuff built around this idea. It would be nice if there was just services that did this for us. And this is what we're going to get into. So you have that classic problem. You see the load balancer. You see the service calling into the load balancer. You see all these services behind it trying to register themselves so that you know in this moving environment where this thing A and B are going to be. They're always moving around, right? They could get moved to node. They need to keep telling the service registry. We can do better. So we introduce this message broker. And the message broker is a lightweight messaging protocol. It's pretty dumb. It's binary. It's AMQP. It's a standard. You get reliable delivery. It's load balanced by default. The message broker takes care of it. You get more of this topology where your services on the outside only need to know about where the broker is. They don't need to know about each other. They just coordinate on queues. They coordinate on the contents of the message, so making sure my data scheme is the same. And it's quick, it's cool, and we have great services for it. So one of the problems with running these in the past is actually running a message broker yourself. Have you ever run Rabbit?
Yeah. Almost all of them over the years I've ran, and nobody likes.
I dig Erlang. I don't want to look at an Erlang stack trace.
No.
so we do that for you. And the benefit of this is I throw a message in
Erlang
that queue.
Erlang stack processing as a service.
No, thank you. Imagine you have a queue out there. I toss a message into the queue. It's asynchronous. I'm waiting for a response back, possibly from that service, hopefully. But they're decoupled. So that service has made that connection to that queue and may pop that message and then respond when it's ready. It doesn't matter where it's at that moment. That's the temporal disconnect, right? And this is a really cool semantic. So Event Hubs gives us this, the Event Hub service gives us this massive ingress and egress of messages. We can use it for log collection. We can use it for IoT solutions. We can take in tons of messages and then also read those messages and process them in streams. Service Bus gives us the ability to like route messages, filter messages, do pub sub, do queues. You get retry semantics. It's all built in and it's all load balanced. And then you get Event Grid, which is all HTTP based. Those first two are AMQP, binary protocol standard. And Event Hubs, or Event Grid, gives us this HTTP endpoints that we can use to relay events and guarantees delivery, that kind of good stuff.
So when would you want to use one over another?
That's a great question. So Event Hubs you would want to use for, like I said, large log ingress, egress, stream processing where you need at least one time that the event gets processed. So in Event Hubs, you can go and throw tons and tons of messages in. We're talking about like gigabytes per minute, that kind of ingress. And then you have a partitioned consumer. So a single consumer consumes a single partition. And you can have hundreds of partitions. I think we crossed 1,000, but I don't want to say that for sure. But we test up to 256 partitions. So you have a receiver for each one of those. Service bus is more like, I want to make sure this financial record gets processed. So I want to know if this financial transaction got processed. If it didn't get processed, I want it to go in a dead letter queue, so I'm guaranteed that I'm going to look at it later.
Okay.
Event Grid is more like, it's not huge throughput, it's more, I want to get notified when this webhook gets hit, right? I want to know when a blob was created in storage.
Events that are triggering some action or something, more so than actually like sending a ton of data to it.
Yep, precisely. Okay. So without further ado, let's look at some code, right? Okay, so we built these new libraries in Go. And we have an Event Hub library, and we also have a Service Bus library. Those are located at, we have GitHub and Event Hub Go. You can go out there and grab the library. And in here, we have this little command line. This is kind of what we use to test some ingress. So this is a Cobra command. It's called max test, and this is a test hub project. And here, I'm going to go create a new token provider here with SAS key and SAS name for Event Hub. And then I'm going to make sure that the Event Hub is partitioned. And then I'm going to spin off based on the number of senders, how many senders I want to go start sending into the queue. So a sender itself actually just goes through, creates a new Event Hub, given the namespace, the hub name, the token provider, and a variadic set of options. So like, who do I want to send to? And then goes through and starts sending messages. So we try to maximize batch size here. So you can batch up a bunch of events, pack them together, and send it.
Now, when you said new hub, that's not actually provisioning an instance of Event Hub. That's just...
It would, if you asked it to.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. So we kind of mix the management plane and the data plane here. So that, and meaning you can provision new Event Hubs, and you can also just start using them. So it's really nice. Like, you want to have that experience together. So here, we're going to go see how this runs. Here. So I set up a connection string already, so we just pass this in, and yay. So those are how many messages were sent in so far. And I have a really bad connection here because we're on Wi-Fi and I can't really maximize there. So before here, I sent a bunch of stuff into, I did a deployment out to Kube. So I'm going to get some pods, see my pods out there. All right, cool. So I have 7 senders in Kubernetes right now running that are actually pretty near to the service. And let's go look and see how many of these have sent. I started them up this morning. Let's see. All right, so I think it's a pretty healthy number. Is that 93 million or 9 million,
9.3? 93 million.
Yeah, that's pretty good. Multiply that by 7 or so.
Yeah, web scale.
Yeah, let's see what this thing actually looks like. Here is the last 6 hours, and we're averaging close to 8 million messages per minute or so. And throughput is about 8 gigs or so. So you want to throw some messages at it? And this is just managed. Like, you don't have to go and deal with spinning up and provisioning stuff. All you do is turn it on, tell it how many throughput units you want to use, like how many compute units I'm going to use, and it'll spin up and expand as needed. It's really cool.
That's...
Yeah. It's fun. So, any questions about Event Hub?
No, I just want to flood it. I want to take it down. Yes. That's just the nature. I like to break stuff. Well, how many messages will it take?
Yes, let's see. So we actually have some great tests there. And if you go out to the repo, I've placed out our tests and what we've done to ensure the library runs for a long period of time. It's robust. And to see how much it'll take, up to 100 throughput units. So we have provisioned like private infrastructure internally, and we run it for days on end just to make sure this thing's bulletproof, right? Because you don't want that stuff breaking down.
Yeah, once I get a hold of it.
Bring it. File a bug, please. We will fix it quickly. All right, so the next one is Service Bus. So Service Bus is a little bit different beast. You aren't going to be using it for huge ingress. You're going to be using it more for queue, routing, filtering, and you know, ensuring that a message gets processed, right? Okay. That one before is at least once. This is, I want it processed only one time. Like, you don't want to debit your account two, three times, right? You want it once.
I want your account debited more than once.
And then transferred?
Exactly.
All right, so from here, we actually have a Buffalo app. So Buffalo is a very, how can I put it, a popular web framework these days, and it is already running. Cool, thanks, Buffalo. You killed the other thing in that address and started a new one. You are awesome. I love you. All right, so let's see here. Let's see if this will run. Here we go. All right. So here, we have a little Buffalo app that's running, and it's going to ask us to log in. And when it goes to log in, it's going to go hit off AAD, and it's going to log in, and it's going to grab my email, and it's going to say, hey, I'm going to send you an email. So let's see this thing working. So it's head off. It's authenticated. Now it's sending an email to me. All right, that's great. Now, what happened there?
It sent an email.
I know, right? Super great. Thanks a lot. what we did is we have Buffalo comes with this simple worker, and the simple worker just spins off a Go prog, and it's a Go routine, and it's going to just run stuff within process, right? And that's pretty useful, but if you're process gets killed, anything happens, you know, that work is lost, right? There's no backing to it. There's also a Redis backing to it as well. But what we did is we put together a lovely implementation using the worker interface. And so you just provide it your connection string, create a new service bus, and tell it what queues you're going to be listening to. And then you set it in the worker for the app. And then you can register your job. So for example, I registered my login email. So that's neat. It's going to successfully send an email, and it just email notification. So we have our really rich email service here. So it works, and that's really neat. But what happens if it fails? So I want to see what happens when I fail this thing. Let's get rid of args. And so we're rebuilt. And let's go log in one more time. And we're going to see, oh no, I failed again. And it continues this way. It'll continue that way for 10 times. That's okay. Configurable on the queue. We can configure that as we want. And then we're looking at putting in smarter worker constraints. So based on delivery count, you have an exponential back off or something like that. And then you can also see that in Service Bus, if we hop over there, we'll see our queue for email as soon as it comes up.
And when you're talking about the exponential back off, that would be for something like you kept tripping up against API limits for whatever the
Totally.
Thing you're using is or something.
Yeah, I'm using X provider and it's a transient error. I want to retry it, okay? But even if I didn't, I still now can start seeing dead letters. So these dead letters, after that thing is processed X number of times that you set, it'll then get dropped into the dead letter queue. So you know this thing didn't get processed. And you can go look at it at the end of the day. go see what went wrong. Maybe I should attach my error case to it so that I can see what that error was. You know, it's really nice for job processing. And that's something we do all the time in web jobs, right? Or web apps. You want to be able to process those. So, and what does it look like to actually queue up that job? That's where it gets fun too. So it's just as simple as this. You just call worker job queue email and tell it the handler. And our handler is login email. So that's about as easy as it gets.
So here inside this application, it is both serving the purpose as the publisher and the subscriber. It has the worker running as well as doing that.
Yeah, yeah. And we can build in richer semantics as well around, as I said, queues, topics, and subscriptions. Queues are, as you would think, simple queues. Topics are really cool. Topics are like queues that you can't receive from, but you can create subscriptions to. So you could subscribe to the queue and pop the messages off into each subscription. So this is kind of a broadcast. And those broadcasters can start filtering on those subscriptions. So you could put your logic for just like, hey, I don't want to hear about this stuff, up into the managed service. Never deal with it.
So you're only getting the messages that you're actually interested in. Now that's perfect.
Yeah, yeah. It's really easy. I like easy. I'm really lazy. This helps me be lazy.
I think that's why we're programmers, right? We're lazy. We don't want to have to do the same task twice.
I totally agree.
Well, thanks so much for joining us.
Eric, thanks for having me. It's awesome.
So today we learned all about the options available for events and messaging inside Azure for Go developers here on Azure Friday.